Tán tamán de ceisteanna don ara educas agus tosnóimid le ceisteanna listáilte. It is time for questions to the Department of Education, and we will start with listed questions. I call Steve Aiken.
Question one, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker.
Minister.
Thank the member for his question. Under Articles 17 and 18 of the Education and Libraries Northern Ireland Order 2003, responsibility for child protection in schools falls to schools' boards of governors. Schools, however, must have regard to guidance issued by the department, and the key document in this respect is the Pastoral Care in Schools Child Protection. It's under the DE Circular 1989/10. As that document explains, teachers and others working in the education services have a significant contribution to make to the safeguarding of children. All schools and colleagues should create and maintain a safe environment for children and young people. Child protection protocols in schools should also include the following. One, school governors should ensure that their school has a child protection policy and procedures based on the guidance provided by DE and the Education Authority. Two, as part of these procedures, each school should have a designated teacher to whom all allegations or suspicions of child abuse should be referred for notification to social services. And thirdly, that all staff should be trained to be alert to the signs of possible abuse and know the action to take if they have concerns. Schools themselves don't have an investigatory role in relation to child protection concerns. There are protocols in place which refer to the relevant concerns to the relevant agencies, most pertinently, I suppose, the social services and the PSNI. The overarching policy framework and relative responsibilities across departments and agencies for safeguarding children is outlined in the Department of Health's publication, Cooperating to Safeguard Children and Young People in Northern Ireland.
Steve Aiken for a supplementary.
Thank you. In light of recent sentencing of a man caught in possession of abuse manuals who was employed at a school to only 12 months imprisonment and 2 years on licence, and now due to be released because of time already served awaiting trial, can the Minister outline what conversations he has had with the Justice Minister on this very serious issue?
If the implication of his question is that the level of sentencing, particularly in that case, I think is something that will outrage people in terms of the level of leniency. I've always been someone who's supported a level of mandatory sentences, and these matters, I think, something that I suspect that he would have a similar view in relation to that. But there's also a case that we need to ensure that that the judiciary actually take these things seriously. There will always be some level of flexibility within that. It is important that particularly the most vulnerable in our society, and particularly school children, are properly given protection, particularly when we're talking about abuse issues, and particularly when we're talking about abuse in terms of at schools, where there is a duty of protection that is put in place there. So I think I would share with him a desire to see much tougher sentences arising out of this, and I think it's something that needs to be progressed.
I call Carla Lockhart.
And can I thank the Minister for his answers thus far? Can the Minister just confirm to the House what the legislation is around this particular issue?
Well, in terms of child protection, I suppose there is a sort of a broad range of both international and domestic legislation relating to welfare. I suppose the principal domestic legislation is under the Children Northern Ireland Order 1995. It's the overarching piece of legislation. Sets out the requirements for professional practice in relation to children and young people and identifies the welfare of children as being the paramount importance, which I think is correct, and sets prevention and protection as two of the key principles. There's also, I think, in terms of the duties that are directly placed on Board of Governors, the Education and Libraries Northern Ireland Order 2003, which obviously now covers the Education Authority as well, but it places a statutory duty on Board of Governors to safeguard and promote the welfare of children, to have a written child protection policy and specifically address the prevention of bullying in schools. Obviously, last year, in terms of on the issues of bullying, there was direct anti-bullying legislation also put through this House. There's also, I think, the Sexual Offenders Northern Ireland Order 2008, which incorporated, I think, significant changes to law in relation to sexual offences to provide for better protection for young people from sexual abuse and exploitation. And I suppose, finally, there's a requirement within the Children's Cooperation Act, which was passed through this House in 2015, which, quote, every children's authority, so much as is consistent with the proper exercise of children functions, cooperate with other children's authorities and other children's service providers in the exercise of those functions. So there's an overarching bit to try to ensure that there is that cooperation, because this isn't just an issue that relates, obviously, to education. There are key implications, particularly for health and for justice, and I think it's only by that level of key cooperation that we can start to tackle these problems.
I call Robbie Butler.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. Question number two.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, with your permission, I'm going to answer questions two and three together, because they relate to the same subject. I am disappointed that NASUWT are engaged in ongoing industrial action. The recognised negotiating forum for teachers' terms and conditions is the Teachers' Negotiating Council, at which the department is represented. TNC, I think, is made up of representatives from the Northern Ireland Teaching Council, comprising the five trade unions and also teaching unions, and management side, which comprises representatives from Education Authority, CCMS, sectoral interests, and the department. Management side meets regularly with the Teaching Council as part of its work on TNC, and it's committed to moving forward in a constructive fashion. Management side met with the teaching unions on the 12th of January, 10 days ago, in relation to the industrial action. And I welcome the fact, I think, that that meeting was described by those who were involved as being constructive. I understand there was agreement to an exchange of discussion papers. And indeed, in terms of a further meeting, it's actually scheduled for tomorrow. I think that that at least, I suppose if we're looking for positive steps forward, I think that is at least a positive step forward, that there is that engagement. And I'd urge the teaching unions, who have taken, to be fair, slightly different attitudes in terms of industrial action, to continue to get round the management side, I think particularly to focus in on the issues for 2017 and beyond.
Robbie Butler for a supplementary.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. Thank you for your answer, Minister. We do welcome any ongoing talks, but can you outline any actions that you have taken to ensure that teachers will be adequately paid, work under acceptable conditions and with a manageable workload, and with the appropriate support to deliver the education for our children and young people in this crisis?
A number of things, I think, that in relation to that. In terms of workload, I think there is a key issue which has been raised, I think, by a lot of teachers with me. That's why whenever we saw it, I think, from schools, and indeed we're ending, suppose, the collation of responses in terms of not simply where there could be additional responsibility or opportunities for a greater level of flexibility for schools. Why it was sort of sought, not simply that, but also to see if there's any suggestions in terms of easing burdens. Because I think, particularly in a very tight financial situation, looking to where we can actually ease burdens on schools and ease burdens on teachers, I think, is vitally important as well. Can I say, I'm also a little bit disappointed, I suppose, that even for those unions that have taken the view of non-strike action, that there is sort of an impact in terms of the non-cooperation around inspectorate, because I think that that can impact on pupils' learning. As regards the broader financial situation, I think it is important that there is a focus of where we move on from 2017, because there isn't a big pot of money sitting somewhere that's ready to be paid to make up for what has happened to date. I should also indicate that in terms of previous settlements, they did also include increments which are something which are no longer automatic within England. But it is actually about trying to get a situation, and hopefully tomorrow will be the first step in this, and actually people looking forward, rather than trying to resolve issues, some of which actually date back many, many years in that regard. And maybe that's a wider lesson for society in Northern Ireland.
Éireann Saoire, Richie McPhillips.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, and thanks to the Minister for his question so far. Would the Minister agree that the potential for a resolution to teachers' pay has been compromised due to the shenanigans that has gone on in this Assembly? And is the Minister confident that a resolution will be found post-election when he himself abandons his post?
Well, I'm not sure abandoning is quite the correct word on that side of things on it. Although clearly we have had, I think, in terms of issues around the broader perspective, the fact that the executive has been collapsed by one party, the fact that in particular it's been done ahead of any budget settlement is not helpful to the overall situation. I think the opportunity for greater level of resolution and greater level of resulting that is if people actually look forward to 2017. It is not realistic that there is some big pot of money that is out there to cover the situation between 2015 and now, or indeed to backdate that. It's also the case that it's not simply a question of finding a one-off pot. If you make changes to the pay and conditions, that actually has a long-term impact in terms of the school budgets and places a level of pressure because it baselines within that. So that is also to be borne in mind. I think the opportunities for that will be actually in potentially looking forward to 2017. The reality is that whether it's myself or whether it's somebody else in post, the issues ultimately remain the same. And I think simply a belief that if there is some form of change of personalities, that this is suddenly going to make resolution very easy, I think that in many ways misunderstands the nature of the problem.
I call Danny Kennedy.
Principal Deputy Speaker, for that. Can I ask the Minister to particularly bear in mind and look closely at the work being carried out by the ETI, the Inspectorate, during this industrial action period? Because a school in my constituency, Kirtamnet Primary School, has been informed that a monitoring inspection will take place.
The Member have a question.
Tomorrow. Given that ETI will be able to finalise a complete report because of the industrial action, will the Minister undertake to look at this situation to ensure that no school is left with an unsatisfactory finding, damage to their school reputation as a result of circumstances beyond their control?
I call the Minister.
There may be certain things that are beyond my control as well in relation to that, but what is the case? I think that it is unfortunate that the particular approach has been taken towards Inspectorate, because I think that can be both damaging to the school, it can be damaging to the reputation particularly of the school, and also to the whole purpose. Let us remember, the inspector are not doing their work because they get some sort of perverse kick out of this. They're doing it to try to ensure that we have proper standards within our schools. And I think a non-cooperation, in certain regards, ETI is always a little bit of the easy target on that basis on it. And I think sort of that non-cooperation, though, is damaging, as I said, to our schools and to our children. And I would urge all the unions, indeed all teachers, to fully cooperate with ETI. And I think that's where we need to see a degree of solution on this as well.
Irm, sir, Chris Little. I call Chris Little.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. In addition to teacher pay, there are a wide range of issues facing education in Northern Ireland at the moment. The suspension of the SEN nursery review, the rejection of school budgets, proposed school bus charges, and most recently
Can
youth
the member
workers
come
put
to
on
his question?
Protective notice. I, as acting chair of the Education Committee, have invited the Minister to provide a fuller update on these issues this Wednesday at our committee. Can I ask the Minister if he is going to be able to attend?
Yes, I'm happy to attend that. I mean, there may be, I think, in terms of a range of those issues, a limited amount that I can directly say. The broader budgetary situation will be the same, I think, for each of the departments, according to the way the rules work, assuming that we're not immediately seeing a resolution to all those issues. In terms of, and I'll be happy to tackle, I suppose, in detail some of the questions that the member has raised, it should also be indicated, I suppose, that in some cases there has been some talk of particular proposals when, in fact, no proposals have necessarily been put in some cases. So maybe the purpose a little bit, and I tried to make comment today on a particular issue which had come up, where again there was a degree of misunderstanding, and indeed, while some not in this House who've actually looked to make sort of a level of political exploitation of that without knowing the facts on that basis. Mm-hmm. On it. But it is important that we shed as much light as possible. I think, and it may well come up in other questions on it, in terms of reviews, consultations, etc. Anything that I think is coming back into the EA is not in and of itself suspended, but I think any actions that would be taken, any consideration on it, because I think the protocols is that you don't really perform consultations during an election period. And I think he mentions, for instance, in terms of the SEN review, and there are other reviews as well, these are very, very important issues, and I think it's important that we get a proper focus on them and that there's not a distraction in those. But I'll be happy to come along to the committee to answer questions effectively on my own on those issues, and I will try and be as helpful as possible within the constraints of the level of knowledge that I have.
I call Lord Morrow.
Principal Deputy Speaker, could I ask the Minister what guidance has the employers issued to schools in relation to the proposed industrial action?
Obviously, guidance has been issued, I think, from employers, and I suppose from that point of view, that can be the Education Authority, it can be CCMS, for instance. To boards of governors and school principals to assist schools in the face of escalated industrial action. And I suppose it particularly advises school principals to consider contingency plans and ascertain what the impact of the industrial action will be within the school to ensure that appropriate levels of supervision and support can be provided and ensure that accurate recording of attendance for pupils and staff and consider the provision of home-to-school transport and school meals. I would indicate as well that whenever you sometimes drill down into the figures in terms of the impact of particular days of action, it's not necessarily, while some of them are geographically specific, it's not even necessarily a universal position. Sometimes it depends upon which union is creating that level of industrial action, their level of strength within that particular school. And for a lot of schools, they've actually been able to carry on without a particular level of impact. Others have had to effectively close the school for that particular day or for a half day. Others have a different regime. So there's a slightly more of a spectrum of impact rather than necessarily being a full impact on schools on any one particular occasion.
I call Sammy Douglas.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Question number four, please.
Thank the member for his question. I believe that community-based initiatives are one of a number of factors that can help improve educational outcomes for pupils. In particular, I think those from socially disadvantaged backgrounds. And in my experience, depending on, irrespective of what community it is, if you're getting that level of community buy-in, I think it is very helpful and be very significant to that. The policy of every school a good school highlights that a good school is one connected to the local community. I've met with a number of community representatives and recognising the influence that they can exercise and achieve. I suppose specifically in terms of in terms of the West Belfast Partnership Board, in terms of the partnership boards in Belfast, including the East Belfast Partnership Boards, I think I've encouraged them to assist them to share the model of good practice. I also fund, I think, both the West Belfast Partnership Board and also the Greater Shankill Partnership Board, and indeed Sure Start as well. So all those, I think, can play an important role, I think, within the community in helping to deliver that key problem, tackling that key problem of educational underachievement.
Sammy Douglas for supplementary.
Thank a member for the Minister for his answer thus far, and I certainly would concur he's been very helpful in the various partnerships. And I declare an interest as well, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm a member of EastSide Partnership in East Belfast. But could I ask the Minister, he's certainly aware of the issues surrounding underachievement, and particularly for young Protestant boys. Could the Minister maybe outline what his department is doing at the moment and maybe plans to do for the future?
Discussion about this, and I welcome some of the improvements that have happened already, but there's a lot more needs to be done to build on this. I had a paper that was produced a short time ago. We're looking to see what we can do in terms of implementing that. And indeed, in terms of, first of all, in tough economic times, I've ensured that the money that's there in funding in terms of things like the targeting social need has been allocated directly to schools. But also I think that we need to take a more imaginative approach. We need, for instance, to focus in on how we can imaginatively use the likes of social media. I would like to see a situation relatively near future that, particularly in terms of the encouragement of reading, that we make use of local role models, maybe sort of the likes of, and it has happened at lower levels within currently, such as, for instance, sports stars, to try to provide a degree of additional aspiration to that. I'm speaking, I think, also at a conference which has been organised in Bangor by a North Down group in the near future, also on the issue of education underachievement. It's been on track for a period of time on it, and I think it's about building a range of those. I mean, if there was a single intervention which could actually sort out a lot of the problems, then I think it would have been done by now. But it's about getting that cocktail of measures of what will work in a particular area and getting that community buy-in.
Thank you very much.
Claimer Colin McGrath.
Principal Deputy Speaker. Many community initiatives are delivered by the Youth Service, and many youth workers across Belfast received protective notices this week because of a funding issue, and I welcome the statement that the Minister has made today.
Can the member come to his question, please?
For my question, I was wondering if the Minister could give some assurance to work with his department that if the money in the budget is made available, that those people's jobs will be secure.
I think that would be the case, and I say it was potentially coming up on question six. I thank the member for helping to raise this issue before we actually reached the 2:30 cut-off point. Now, can I say, first of all, I think there was concern, I think, because a letter was put out by an official within EA, which is essentially the protective notice. That is the standard practice and happened, for example, 2 years ago whenever there was an issue with the, because of the welfare situation as regards the budget. It is, if you like, the standard procedure where no budget has been set. But I think, unfortunately, there's been inferences have been drawn from that. Let me, and indeed some who deliberately misinterpret, let me make the thing absolutely clear. First of all, there has been no cuts whatsoever to that budget. Number two, there has been no decision to make any cuts to that. And thirdly, there is no proposal to make a cut to it and no intention to make any cut to that. That money is currently being allocated. It will, and we'll have an opportunity with the committee to talk about the wider situation as regards that. It would appear likely that the budget will simply roll forward in the absence of a budget, which means that money will be spent in more or less the same ways. This was, as I said, a precautionary move which had to be taken, and it's in line with what had happened in previous years. But I want to give that reassurance because I understand there's a lot of concerns out there at present.
I call Andy Allen.
Principal Deputy Speaker, can I ask the Minister how he will support community childcare providers as the most cost-effective childcare option?
Well, I think we're working indeed with childcare providers. There are a range of... you're right in terms of wanting to try to make sure that we have... we never see the biggest bang for our buck. I suppose in particular, given limited resources, you always want to try and make sure that it reaches the maximum number of... the maximum sort of provision that is there. We had a childcare strategy, I think, was ready to go to the executive in relation to that, but I think the department will work with local childcare providers to try to provide that help and support, as has happened up until now, on that issue.
Call Naomi Long.
Principal Deputy Speaker, the Minister has indicated the need to follow good practice. Could he confirm the total funding that his department can award to the West Belfast Full Service Community Network Education Framework, and whether he would consider similar funding for the EastSide Learning Education Framework in order that the good practice that has been instilled in West can be rolled out in East?
Well, from that point of view, obviously the Member can appreciate in terms of if we're looking an exact amount in terms of figures, I will write to the Member with that result. And I think, yes, we do always want to see if we can get best practice that is there. Obviously, given the limitations of the time that I have in office, the opportunity to, for example, roll out new initiatives is extremely limited in terms of the short period of time, but I think it is something that needs to be considered by, if not, then if I'm not in a position to do it myself, then by successors in title. I think there's a reasonable suggestion that's been put forward.
I call Andy Allen.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, question 5, please.
I thank the member for his question. I should explain that while parents are able to nominate their preference for the preschool settings or schools they wish their child to attend, improved enrolment numbers mean that it's not every case that a child can be guaranteed a place in a particular setting or school. Nevertheless, I think the figures for September 2016 admission, which have been provided by the Education Authority and are based upon the position at the close of each of the admissions process, show that the vast majority of children in East Belfast were successful in gaining admission to their first preference. So drill down into that in terms of the statistics. In terms of preschool places, there were 1,106 available preschool places throughout East Belfast for this year. Preschool settings collectively received 1,068 applications, of which 937 of those, which is around about 90%, achieved the places at their first preference setting. In the terms of the primary sector, there are 1,207 places. There were 1,094 primary applications received. Of those, 1,021 of those applicants received places at their first preference. That equates to 93.3%. Post-primary figures are as follows. There were 1,028 places available. 1,025 post-primary applications were received, with 807 receiving their places at the first preference school. Now, I would emphasise again, these figures do not relate to children placed at one of the schools of their choice, but at the first preference of their choice.
Andy Allen for supplementary.
Minister, for his answer. Minister, given the uncertainty at the prospect of the proposals in the draft area plan, can you outline what work your department has undertaken to identify and address any shortage of school places in East Belfast to help increase the prospect of children securing their first preference school and the school best suited for their needs?
It's important that, yes, children do get the best suited one. That doesn't mean always just that something entirely just on their own doorstep. You know, in terms of area planning, the idea of that is actually to provide something fairly strategically, and we will see, if you like, a draft area plan in relation to that. That will lend itself potentially to development proposals, and that can happen. While obviously everybody's thinking around development proposals will always think around either a new school or a closure of a school or a merger school. That can also actually relate to, and has happened on a number of occasions, in terms of adjustments, in terms of enrolment. Development proposals themselves can take a certain length of time, and there is the provision, which has happened in a number of occasions, to allow temporary variations, which the school actually applies for from that point of view now, and they will be viewed, if you like, if there's a particular pressure, can then be met by that. Could indicate, I suppose, directly as regards development proposals, as it would be the department, and more specifically the minister, who would then sign off on a specific development proposal. The department itself will not be the initiator of a development proposal. It will come through, for example, the education authority or the other managing authority to initiate that. But as I said, as has happened in a number of schools, there is an opportunity, I think, to ensure that that can be dealt with, and, you know, at least then provide temporary constraints, or sorry, temporary removal of constraints.
I call David Hilditch.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, are there any plans to revise the criteria for preschool admission?
Well, obviously, preschool education provides set admission criteria. Obviously, research has shown that children from socially disadvantaged circumstances tend to experience more difficulty at school than other children. And so the department requires priority as given to those within preschool setting as part of a wider effort. Obviously, the aim is to try to ensure, which to be fair has been pretty much closely got to, that we have a situation in which there is at least a place for every child. Sometimes I think there's still a level of disjoint in terms of almost an area planning point of view, in that in certain parts of the country you will have a high level of pressure on places and other areas where there's a degree of gap. It is important, I suppose, that the definition of children with socially disadvantaged circumstances in the required priority criteria, and I think, are fit for purpose. So I think that it is probably timely that those would be revised, and if indeed there is any revision of those, I would indicate, obviously, that any changes would be subject to consultation.
I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. And I thank the Minister very much for his answers so far. Does the Minister's analysis take into account the fact that integrated schools in the area are regularly oversubscribed, and that this means that parental demand for integrated education is not being met?
Well, if you, as I said, there is an indication that we need, as part of this, to get an overall holistic view in terms of the area plan. I think that's where we need to move ahead, which will identify the needs, particularly for Belfast and, I suppose, for East Belfast. Within that context, I think one of the useful things in terms of the process so far in area planning has been that all of the sectors, I think one of the criticisms that was rightly made of area planning in the past was that you had different sectors moving at different speeds. And so the fact that it's not just simply involving the controlled school sector and CCMS, but that, for example, the integrated sector, the Irish medium sector, are all sitting around the same table trying to develop those proposals, you know, will hopefully produce a plan which is fit for purpose, and where there are particular pressures, and if, for example, there are particular pressures on the integrated sector within East Belfast, that those are taken account in part of an overall plan. But it's important that we get the full jigsaw, if you like, as part of that.
I call Nelson McCausland.
Question number six, please.
The Education Authority has confirmed that there are a total of 41 youth workers across the statutory provision in the three areas named. The figure, I suppose, is made up of 15 workers, there's 41 in total, 15 workers in the Rathcoole Youth Centre, which include seven youth support workers, seven assistant youth support workers, five youth support workers, two support workers in charge, and one area youth worker. There's a further 10 at the Mill Green Youth Centre in Bonmore, and 16 at the youth workers in Glengormley Youth Centres, and I could give the member the breakdown of those if he so desires.
Nelson McCausland for a supplementary question.
Could I thank the Minister for his answer and for his answer to the earlier question regarding uncertainties that existed around some issues of youth funding? Could I ask the Minister, thank the Minister for his clarification, and ask him then what his assessment is of the value, the benefits that flow from that work that we're speaking about?
I think there's a tremendous benefit, which is why the funding consistently has been put on a separate footing, and indeed the EA has always sought to deliver that. Because I think particularly in sometimes difficult areas, this is particularly targeted at youth work with young people who are actually sometimes very hard to reach, that indeed perhaps other services are not really getting to in that regard. And I think it's important that that provides, it provides a key prevention, I think, from society as a whole, both for the in terms of any potential problems that arise, but also for those individual young people, that they from that point of view, do not go down a wrong direction. So I think that the youth work that is provided is extremely valuable, and I commend those that are involved within that.
Sin Gerin Atreivsha, the question list Dolcha. That ends the period for listed questions. An ishta quick bomage jig, the question of Trahula Agin, August Glamour Alan Chambers. We will now move on to 15 minutes of topical questions, and I call Alan Chambers.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, as we head towards an election, no doubt yourself and the other candidates in North Down will be getting asked questions regarding the capital investment programmes that have been planned for around Prairie College in Holywood and Columbanus College in Bangor.
The member come to his question.
Can you give us an update on where those capital investment programmes are?
Of issues. I mean, I suppose all politics is local. I suppose the member can't be blamed for posing that. As regards very specifically Priory College and also it was Central Integrated, they have been part of the Fresh Start announcements. The project boards are moving ahead with those. That money is secure and indeed happening in that regard. And irrespective of what particular political landscape, if it's, those are moving ahead. As regards St Columbanus, certainly I've sought from government to see if some of the terms in terms of the broader funding side of things can be widened, because I think St Columbanus particularly provides, I suppose, what is sometimes referred to as a supermix school in terms of its intake, and I think it should be in a position to benefit from that. As yet, I think the government centrally has probably been a little bit distracted with other issues, so I've not been able to secure, if you like, a widening of the terms of reference. It is likely, I think, because again tied up with that was the examination of what could be done in terms of the school enhancement programme, that there will be an announcement fairly imminently on that. And that's really because we need to get moving on with school enhancement programme to ensure that there is a proper flow of capital on that side of things. But I'm acutely aware of the issues that are there. Again, no matter how things move ahead, there will be capital that will be available in the future. We've not yet been in the position to actually make a major capital call. But I think there will be one very eminently on the school enhancement programme.
Alan Chambers for supplementary.
Thank you, Principal Speaker. I just could ask the Minister then if this money that you say is secured for the two of the schools, is it real money or is it subject to budgetary constraints in the future? And could I also ask if you've had any informal meetings with the schools around this?
Well, I've met, yeah, I mean, certainly as regards, first of all, in terms of meetings, I have been to both Priory, I've been to a number of schools clearly, I've been directly in terms of the issue with both Priory and Central Integrated. They are part of the Fresh Start money, which was £500 million allocated across a 10-year period, with a tranche, if you like, of a maximum of £50 million per year. Those schools were announced as part of the first tranche of investments. As I said, the actions being taken are then, if you like, progressing along those lines. The issue in relation to that is that money is therefore secured, irrespective of what happens to the Northern Bloc grant, irrespective of what happens to any Northern Ireland executive budget. That is separate money which has been allocated by government centrally in that regard. It is secure money. They are announced projects. They are moving ahead. I think, for instance, in the case of Priory, albeit I think a lot of us would have a fair degree of guess at what the answer is. The first step is actually, for example, to ensure that you have a proper site that can be, I think, in both that case and also probably the central, there are fairly obvious answers to that, but that is a procedure which needs to be gone through. But the money is 100% secure and will not be impacted by wider budgetary positions. That's a bit of good news for the member.
I call Keith Buchanan.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker. Could I ask the Minister, has there been any feedback from school principals regarding the entitlement framework?
I mean, look, this was a practical decision which was taken and indeed, it's something I think where we were getting messages, particularly from school principals from schools, that what was there was placing a high level of onerous burden in terms of the scale that was there. Now, nobody doubts that we need to ensure that there's the fullest level of opportunity for people. So I had that before the decision was taken. I've had a number of items of feedback from school principals subsequent to then who see it as a practical solution which has actually eased the burden on them in tight financial situations. I would also take this opportunity, I know a lot of schools are doing this already, but I think that particularly in terms of the delivery of the entitlement framework and indeed the delivery of subjects, I think this is a great vehicle for greater levels of cooperation, collaboration and sharing between schools. So that particularly in some minority subjects where you are getting two or three schools perhaps within the same town, and I know, for instance, it happens in my own constituency in Bangor, for instance, between three of the schools, that they are collaborating to try to provide that maximum level of opportunity. And that, you know, I think, as I said, generally speaking, the announcement has been welcomed by school principals.
Keith Buchanan for supplementary.
Thank you, and thank the Minister for his answer so far. Is this part of a wider authority policy, is it?
Well, as part of a wider authority, I mean, from that point of view, the idea of giving a greater level of autonomy to schools, providing them, indeed, for decisions to be made at the I suppose, in a previous existence, which would show my age, a certain what we describe as the chalk face, now it's supposed to be the interactive whiteboard, indeed, maybe out of date, even in relation to that. It is allowing that opportunity to provide those sensible decisions to be taken at a level by school principals, by boards of governors, by teachers who actually know what is in the best interest for their children, rather than, I suppose, an attempt to dictate downwards simply from the Department of Education. And I think that that is an important step. And again, whoever succeeds me on that basis, whoever's taking those decisions, I think that is something which needs to carry on.
The member listed for topical question number 3 has withdrawn their name. I call Alex Easton.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. Could I ask the Minister to clarify about outdoor activity centres and at the current consultation?
There is a current consultation ongoing, and I'm not in a position directly to interfere with that. There have, however, and I appreciate we had a very vigorous debate, particularly in this chamber. In fact, we had 2 weeks in a row, I think, we had a very vigorous debate on outdoor activity centres. It is clear that there are widespread concerns that are out there. Today I've written to the chair of the Education Authority, and to that letter will be going to all members of the board, I suppose urging a particularly precautionary approach, that whereas I cannot interfere directly in the consultation which is ongoing, that before any conclusions are reached on this, that the authority needs to have a very thorough examination of all consultation responses, that they need to look at what alternative proposals have been put forward, what other options, and I think there can be other options in terms of a better, if you like, financial regime which would allow alternative ways of these to move forward, but very also specifically urging them not simply to look at those but engage directly with those who are putting those forward to ensure, if you like, that we have the fullest opportunity, that the driver should be what is in the best interest of our young people. Well, I appreciate that there are also financial constraints, and therefore I think it's important that every option is explored very thoroughly, and indeed that therefore that the maximum opportunity is given for any viable alternatives. That letter has gone today. It may be news to the Education Authority because they may not have it's simply been sent today, so it may not have been received by them as yet, but that will be going to every member of the Education Authority.
Alex Easton for a supplementary.
Thank you. Could I ask the Minister, will the Minister give a guarantee that he will look at absolutely every option before coming to a final conclusion?
Well, the conclusion initially is to be done by, at least in terms of, by the Education Authority. To that extent, I'm urging them to take that look. I think in terms of where decisions are likely to be taken will be outside the time frame of my ministerial responsibility, but it is important, I think, that whether it's at the level of the Education Authority, and I think that's where the resolution needs to happen, or whether it indeed is in a future position of another minister, it is important, yes, that every avenue is explored, that we provide the best possible solutions, I think, for our young people on this issue.
Paula Bradshaw.
Minister, do you plan to publish the independent review of integrated education before the election when you'll cease to hold office?
I'm tempted to say the very short answer is yes. I received the report. It was shortly before Christmas that I received that. I'd analysed the report itself was a little bit late in arriving, but I looked over it. My intention had been originally to, because I think it's not just a question of publishing, it's a question of seeking the public's views on that. So my intention had been to actually find a date in January to do that. I understand from discussions that the protocol is such, and I think there's good sense in this as well, that you shouldn't really be publishing during an election campaign, in part because that's both the advice in terms of protocols for all consultations, but also this is a very serious report. It is something, I think, which does need to be given a proper viewing. I was also then informed, my original intention, I think, was to publish then to give instructions for the public just after the election campaign to avoid that. I've then been told that I can't do it directly after that, but I've managed to find a way which will mean that I've signed off today on publication of that report on the 2nd of March itself at 9:45 p.m. So no one can accuse me of actually making a political football out of this by way of it impacting on the election, but it goes to the limits of when I actually have the legal power to do that, and I wanted to make sure it is important, this is a serious report, that it is published, that the views of the public are sought on this, and that is a route which we can ensure that all is being done to make sure that this is fully examined by the public.
Paula Bradshaw for a supplement.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister. And I was sort of following what your logic was in that, but I fail to see why you couldn't launch it now. Are you not afraid that, like in many other elections, when important issues have come up against it, then they have just got lost at the far side and it takes many months for them to be picked up again?
Two things in relation to that. First of all, I think the danger on that is, rather than it being treated on its own merits and looked at seriously, it either, on the one hand, simply becomes part of the noise within the election, or indeed, because the focus, and nobody knows precisely what the various issues will be during the election, they'll be fairly wide-ranging, that effectively it almost gets put into a background situation. But I also think, from that point of view, there is protocol which is suggested of what can be done during an election period for any minister, and it lies within the department as part of that. Part of that advice and guidance is that major consultations should not take place during an election, in part because of the danger of whatever the consultation, that it would in some shape or form could be regarded as being party political or could influence the election. So I'm following the protocol, but I'm committed to ensure that this is published, and as I said, I've found a way that in terms of within my power, it is guaranteed that it's published, that it gets a fair examination by the public, and that it will get an opportunity as part of that in terms of seeking those public views, that space can be done, that can be provided. I, you know, had it not been for the election, we would have moved ahead at a quicker pace in that regard on it. But I've got to follow basically what is the protocol during the period, and I think this is a way, I think, of squaring the circle, but ensuring that this very important document is actually put in the public domain.
I call Andy Allen.
Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, given recent figures reveal a 280% increase in waiting times for children waiting on autism assessments, can you advise what your department or indeed the Education Authority are doing to support those children, many of which are waiting up to 2 years for assessments?
Assessments, we're cooperating, I think, with particularly the Department of Health, because a lot of the assessment side of it will be on the health side rather than with the Department of Education. There is a working group trying to work through those issues with the Department of Health. I suppose the key test in terms of delivery will be on the basis of what can actually happen on the ground. And I think what we are faced with the situation is that there's a much greater level of awareness, particularly of autism. I've met with some of the autism groups around about the early autumn in that regard. And I think one of the issues is that thankfully we're actually detecting this a lot earlier, but what that is creating then is a level of pressure on how quickly then those can be processed. You know, my department is happy to work with the Department of Health to try and process those as quickly as possible, but we need to ensure that we get the right diagnosis as well.
Andy Allen for a supplement.
Thank you, Minister, for his answer. And Minister, I'm sure you'll understand and appreciate many of those children waiting on the assessments will have an impact upon their school life. So will you give a commitment to review what support is being offered and also perhaps look at the level of training being offered to teachers and classroom assistants to support those children?
Well, we'll certainly be progressing those issues. I mean, in terms of the delivery of what I can do in the short term, because I suppose we reached dissolution on Wednesday night. But I think there is a very important issue which needs to be progressed, and I will certainly be tasking my officials to try to have that maximum level of cooperation to ensure that waiting times are kept down to a minimum.
Claire Hannah. I call Claire Hannah.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his answer so far. Can I ask the Minister for an update on the investing and teaching workforce scheme?
Well, currently it's in a situation that expressions of interest have been sought. There was a lengthy list that was produced in those who were interested. With that, not the advice, indeed the nature of the pilot scheme that was progressed by the executive was that this was open to 120 in this year. That was felt to be the maximum number that could be progressed. We had a lot more than that indeed. Therefore, those teachers who have been successful in reaching that top 120 have now been written to. There is also, though, a legal challenge from a judicial review point of view. Somebody challenging that will obviously the outcome of that will be critical as to the progress in that. But if that judicial review is not successful, progress will happen to ensure that, at least as regards that pilot scheme, that those will be progressed and reached to a point of conclusion in year.
And that ends. I'm sorry, there isn't time for your supplementary. Can the members take their ease while we change the top table?